Jane goes home with it. So he says, Jesus said to them, did you never read in the scriptures, the stone which the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone. This was the first spirit, and we see it marvelous in our eyes. But then when you start to see things how God is doing it, God's hand in it, this I got here. When we go through things in life, it's necessary for us to, because we experience that walk and we'd not be enjoying the blessings we enjoy now. That's what I've been getting out of it. I don't know what you
said. Say that again, Carol, I didn't quite hear that.
I said, I just wrote some things down. When we go through things in life, because he was rejected, wasn't he? And it says, it's necessary, if we had not experienced this walk, we would not be enjoying the blessings we enjoy now. And the enemy, when we go through things, he intended it for destruction. But God used it for our development, to be more than conquerors. This is what I wrote down. I don't know
That's
if you're getting out of it.
That's correct.
And it says, it means I can stand up and say, this is how I see it. I took everything that I've been through to make me who I am and to teach what I know now. So I choose bitter, better and not bitter. I thought, well, I'll write that down and I'll bring it because it spoke to me. And I think it was really good to think that God was rejected. And sometimes, till we come to know the Lord, we're rejected, aren't we?
Oh, definitely.
You know.
Do you think there's a strong correlation also between the stone being rejected and yet becoming the cornerstone, what could have been used as a cornerstone wasn't, because it had a flaw and it was rejected. That also is like Christ, but also is it akin to the Jacob's pillow stone as well? Maybe, I wonder if that was the stone that they were actually physically talking about. Maybe they were going to use that as a cornerstone in the temple, but because it had a crack in it, they didn't use it.
I think that's just a symbol, you know.
I got here, seeing God's hand in it. So when you go through things in life, whatever happens, when you look back, you can see God's hand in it all. And you had to experience that to get the blessings you've got now.
Without a doubt.
I thought that's what I, you know, I spoke to me and I thought I'll bring that tonight and see if anybody else got anything to add to it.
See, Paul said, I am what I am by the grace of God. There's no works of his, no sort of merit of his whatsoever. God made them. It says we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus to good works, which he has before ordained that we should walk in them.
Yeah.
All the work is God's.
Yeah.
We don't see it, honestly, leading up to it, do we?
No.
Because if when it's our works, we see what's happening. We know what everything's for and how it fits. But when somebody, because God's working on us, we're like confused and we don't see his righteousness until it's fully revealed.
And it's a big temple he's building.
Yeah.
The temple of the living God that he himself is going to indwell.
Yeah.
Now we are living stones that will find our place fitted into that temple. We don't have the knowledge or understanding. We're not the architect.
No.
We're the material.
Yeah.
The architect knows where he has designed that particular material to be placed.
Yeah. The low grade material, aren't we?
But he's fashioning us into gemstones.
And
we will fit into that living temple, which God himself will inhabit.
But you see, that's what I heard of it, seeing God's hand in it. Because as I look back, what things have happened that I expect you all have, you can see God's hand in it all the way. At the time, you've got a job to see it, start off with.
Yeah.
But when you trust God in these things, you can see his hands moving through it.
I've gotten used to failure. I have. And I think there's a reason for that. I think if I was a successful person, then I would not be the person God wants me to be.
If you were a successful person, you'd probably be a horrible person, even worse than what you are now.
Possibly. Went straight to that one, didn't I? Missed that one. We're
prone, us Jacks are prone to become pride,
boastful, and arrogant.
You know, because there's certain things that I get good at, I'm good at certain things. And that is when I get good at these things, I become boastful about these things. And it's not a good way to be, really.
Not really, no.
You know, It's not a good.
It's not your. It's not the path I don't think God wants us to be. It's the reason why I wasn't a professional golfer. It's the reason why I'm not a high flyer earning lots of money somewhere in business. Although I've got the drive for that.
You have made some silly mistakes, Andrew.
Yeah, but did most multi-millionaires made silly mistakes before they made the good ones.
That's right.
Yeah. I'm absolutely right. Yeah.
You know, so
Jeffrey Archer was a bankrupt, wasn't he?
Yeah, three times.
That's crazy. Jeffrey Archer.
Yeah.
Was a bankrupt.
So it's not every time.
Who
not
was
every.
Jeffrey Archer?
You don't hit the
politician.
You don't hit the bullseye every time.
Right,
but we didn't make loads of money.
When you're shooting your gun, you don't hit the bullseye every time. Gonna make mistakes.
Yeah.
It's just that now I've found out it's not what I really want, to be honest. All I really want is just to be content with what I've got. I want God to make me content.
That's wisdom. Because wanting to get stuff, the lie behind that is if I have this and I'll be happy.
Yeah.
So that's not always so. The true wisdom, the true riches is being able to be content and
content.
Satisfied no matter what conditions.
I think you can achieve some level of contentedness, but I got a feeling that God has meant this wellness and death for a reason. You might not always have contentedness.
Well, I think you are content. You're much more content when you have Christ in your life than without Christ.
Yeah. Well, Paul said, he said, I have learned to be content.
Yeah, he did say that. Yeah.
And so we learn. We're constantly learning because we are disciples.
No matter what
of Jesus Christ.
Kind of life throws at us.
Yeah.
We
see, because the thing is this: God has brought us to a position where we are to overcome.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
This world is not to have victory over us.
No. That's where Mum is. You know, she's fought the good fight. And she's overcome the world.
And we need to get. God is bringing us into that realm of overcoming.
Yeah.
Because, Jesus says that his name shall be called Jesus, because he shall save his people from their sins. Yeah. If we're not saved from sin, our salvation is worthless.
Yeah. Yeah.
If we're not saved from evil and committing evil, our salvation is pointless. Yeah. You know, and this is what I was saying to Caroline earlier on today. You know, there is the idea that people can get into their minds where God is going to save everyone, so it doesn't matter how I live.
Yeah, I'm battling with that at the moment, Chris.
It's a fundamental misunderstanding.
Yeah. I mean, I like the fact that perhaps I'm not steering the boat, but I somehow feel that it's not right just to be. Well, I mean, you're going to go where the boat's going to go.
Yeah.
Anyway, you have no choice. If you're on the boat, you're going to go where the boat's going to go.
Yeah.
But. I think along that journey, the boat stops off at certain places, perhaps, and you've got
to God will prompt you to do good things,
yeah.
to be the person which he wants you to be.
That's right.
He's forming you. And when you're not the person, he will chastise you. He'll knock you back into place.
Yeah. That is right.
Yeah.
That is right. And it is the chastisement that then leads us to be straightened out.
Yeah.
Again, it's still God's work.
Sure.
Still God's work.
That's the reason why we're not nasty, horrible, conniving, backstabbing, thieving people. Which I might have been if I wasn't to know Christ. Perhaps I would be like the world, because the world is like that. But we've been taken out of the world, or we are in it.
We're not of the world.
Yeah.
We're not of the world, are we?
We've had a lot.
The actual word that's translated as world there in King James is actually age or aeon.
Mm.
We are in this aeon, but we're not of this aeon. We are in this age, but not of this aeon.
Yeah.
No. Our realm is in the age to come.
That's better. That's
better. Yeah. The word that should be translated only as world should be cosmos.
So maybe that's what Paul was saying when I save a few. Maybe I save a few from this age.
Yeah, pretty much. I think that's what he's referring to. He doesn't say the word age there.
Yeah.
It's a part in Corinthians where he says, "So that I'm all things to all men, so that by all means I may save some." And Stephen was saying, oh, if everybody's going to be saved, then what does that mean? Well, what are you being saved from and what are you being saved to?
Yeah.
What they seem to do, because they believe in hell, they give a blanket saying, any reference to salvation is salvation from hell. And if hell isn't there, then salvation makes no sense. But it makes absolute sense.
Yeah.
So
that's right. Yeah.
It just means that we're saved from eternal death. When Christ died 2,000 years ago, he saved everyone.
Yeah.
But Christ didn't die on the cross, that means when we die, we die.
There was never any other eternal death to be set, or eternal torment to be saved from.
No, that's right. Yeah, it was just
all eternal death to be saved from. The physical death is the end of death.
Yes.
Yeah. So there was never any eternal thing to be saved from.
Yeah, that's right. But once you're dead, it's there's no resurrection, there's no life after that.
There's no hope. You're saved from hopelessness, in fact.
Yeah.
To hope.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. That makes a lot of sense, doesn't it?
And it's a hope that saves us, actually. It's a saving hope.
Well, it's a faith hope, isn't
it? It's saving some, because it's every man in his own order.
That's right, yes.
Only the ones that God has ordained for this age will be saved. All that the Father giveth me shall come to me.
That's right.
And so there won't be anyone lacking at the end of this age. Before ever these ages began, before ever God formed any age, God already knew who would form the body of Christ.
Yeah, yeah.
Who he would place in that spiritual temple.
Yeah.
Who then would comprise the new Jerusalem.
Yeah.
And who would then bring their glory into it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Because it speaks of, you know, it's first Christ.
Yeah.
Then they that are Christ that is coming.
Yeah.
Then comes the end when he delivers up the kingdom of the Father. But in that intervening time, you've got the calling of Israel, the building of the new Jerusalem. And then it says the Gentiles shall bring their glory into it. So there is that order, that progression. Yeah. God knew that before the world began.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah.
And we are Christ's.
Absolutely.
As in, when it says that we are Christ, it doesn't mean that we are going to be like Christ, which I think what it means, or we are Christ's
possession.
Possession, yeah.
All that the Father giveth me shall come to me. So we are God's
both
personal gift.
Yeah, and Christ's.
To the Christ.
And we are going to be like Jesus.
Absolutely. Yeah. It'll That's be right. exactly like him.
So it's both of them.
The head and the body will be exactly of the same substance.
Yeah. So that he may be the firstborn amongst many brethren.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's right. It goes on to say that, doesn't it? Yeah.
And it says he's not ashamed to call them brethren.
Yeah.
You know, those that are called in this age.
Yeah.
Which is an amazing statement.
That is total faith, though, isn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah. That is a faith statement.
But that is God who had that faith in himself.
That's right.
God knew that he could perform all this.
Yeah. Well, I know God, and I know in his power that he can create the universe. So if he's able to make those promises, then I have all the faith in the world that his promise is going to come to fruition.
That's it.
Yeah.
And that's really what you're saying in a way, Carol, all the things that happen to us.
Yeah.
Though we don't understand them at the time, that's why faith is essential.
Yeah.
We have to trust
that's right.
that what God is doing is exactly for our good.
Yeah.
That's the difficult thing. You know, and a perfect example of that is Job. You know, he did trust it.
Yeah.
He did trust God.
Well, you Joseph know, was another one, wasn't he?
The Lord giveth and the Lord taketh away. Blessed be the name of the Lord.
Yeah.
I think with our eyes we don't see properly. There's Martin Zander, he uses an analogy of going onto a building site when it's midway through being built, it looks like a mess.
Yeah.
You know, and if you were to go on there and shout out, what are you doing? This is a mess, they'll think you're crazy because you don't know what the finished product's going to be.
Yeah.
Mm. Mm. And it's the same with our each individual lives.
Mm.
See, when you look at yourself, that's why, you know it's not sensible to actually dwell upon yourself. Because you're a work in progress.
Yeah.
Yeah. You beat yourself.
I can see the potential you're not a finished product. All of you, though. Yeah. That's me. I could see the potential in all of you.
Yeah.
Even in me, Carol.
Yes. You asked him then, he was down in the dumps. I met him in the supermarket and he said, oh, I loved him.
Yeah.
I really love Jesus. And I said, what are you talking about? I said, of course you do. I said, you won't be talking about him. You wouldn't.
Why were you saying that?
No.
I think
did I say that to you?
Yeah, it's an asshole, wasn't it?
The fact that we're here and rejoicing at what this new concept was. To me, it's quite new. The abolition of hell, because I spent a few years in Babylon as well,
enslaved by it.
Coming out of that, and actually hearing these words, have given me huge hope.
Yes.
Yeah.
Enough to deal with my mum's death with a smile on my face almost.
Yeah, that's right.
You know,
because we know that victory's been swallowed.
I mean,
that
has got to be evidence enough. You know.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, I've had my sad times.
Death's been swallowed up in victory, isn't it?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
You do have your sad times, but I cope with it very well.
Yeah, but
and very, very happy.
I have moments, Sam, where I'm quite deep in grief. just because of the physical aspect.
Yes.
Of mum, the physical aspect.
That's inevitable.
Yeah.
You know, we've not yet reached the stage where, you know, there shall be no more sorrow.
That's right.
We haven't reached that yet.
Yeah. I mean,